What was Steven Crowder's career like when it first started? And what was his evolution like from a random guy on YouTube doing his stand-up routine to conservative commentator with a multi-million dollar talk show? So I decided to take a little trip back in time to get a better understanding of what Crowder's content used to be like and what we can learn about it in the present. Since this video isn't a biography about the guy's whole life, let's go through his pre-YouTube life quickly. Steven Crowder was born in Detroit in 1987 and moved to Montreal, Canada when he was 3. He began acting at a young age, notably playing the Brain on the TV series Arthur for 15 episodes. He started doing stand-up comedy at 17 and appeared in a handful of small roles in projects you've likely never seen. Unable to break through in Hollywood, he instead started recording short videos on YouTube expressing his conservative worldview. One of the earliest videos still up on Crowder's channel is titled Hamas, Children, the Gays, and Sarah Palin. The video is a defense of Israel's violence upon the Palestinian people, with lines like this one.
Listen, nobody likes seeing innocent life lost on either side. And to the conservatives out there, give credit where credit's due. These Palestinian children are the most resourceful people on the planet when it comes to finding rocks.
You'll have to excuse me for not finding the humor in children being murdered for supposedly throwing rocks. But this is the sort of comedy Crowder will be dabbling in throughout most of his career. The structure of this video, much like many of Crowder's other early videos, is largely just Crowder doing his stand-up routine into a camera, mixing in jump cuts and the occasional costume change to hammer home his jokes. The production quality is not great, but considering he's just a guy with a camera and it's 2009 on YouTube, that's pretty forgivable. Crowder would upload videos like these every week, mixing his brand of humor and ignorance to create little moments like this, taken from a video where he defends Big Pharma's profit incentive.
Here's the way I look at it. If Richard Simmons can make dozens of million dollars from Dance Your Pants Off Volume 4, the guy who gave us the polio vaccine deserves some loose change.
The creator of the polio vaccine, Jonas Salk, famously refused to patent that vaccine because he put the needs of people ahead of his own personal profit. A fact I thought was commonly known, but you'll find many of Crowder's videos typically are missing or deliberately omit a number of vital facts in order for him to make his points. It's also really weird to watch this video in 2023 because it's such a full-throated defense of the pharmaceutical industry, specifically when it comes to vaccines. Knowing how the politicization of the COVID vaccine would make so many conservatives change face. While it might be tempting to score some easy hypocrisy points here, or brand Crowder a grifter, it's also possible his views have changed over time after being so deeply ensconced in the conservative media space. I think it's important to give people space to grow and change. Although, when it comes to Crowder, it seems like almost all his growth has been in a bad direction. We can see Crowder's style evolve in these early videos as he started to mix little skits into his comedy, rather than just have him speak into the camera directly for the whole thing. It shows a greater understanding of the power this medium has, though more often than not, doing skits just seemed like an excuse for him to dress up and drag, something he did a lot of early on.
That's awful!
Although it's pretty well known that Crowder loves dressing in drag, what was genuinely disturbing in these videos is that one of the Nancy Pelosi ones ended with him waterboarding her.
Shut up, you old bag! It'd be good times.
I should mention, Steven Crowder doesn't consider waterboarding torture, though he seems it as a, I guess, humorous way to punish people he disagrees with politically. In the context of a skit, though, I don't think he genuinely wants to waterboard Nancy Pelosi. I also want to mention something that's happening with his humor here. He's wearing this weird lipstick because the joke is that Nancy Pelosi is the Joker, which doesn't make sense. I'm not sure how a politician who represented, at the time, the ruling political party was also the Joker. This is emblematic of a lot of Crowder's comedy. If a reference pops into his mind, he'll shout it out as if it's a joke. But his references often make little to no sense. They're usually based on the most superficial similarities. In this case, Nancy Pelosi has a big smile, therefore, she's the Joker. That superficial layer is as deep as it gets. I suspect it's not the wit people are enjoying with videos like these, but rather seeing Nancy Pelosi being violently assaulted. With comedy like this, Crowder was very quickly noticed by Andrew Breitbart, the man who famously coined the term, "Politics is downstream from culture." Breitbart was a major figure in the right-wing media space, helping it move away from discussing politics and instead trying to move their agenda to discussing culture. Crowder, as a young man with energy and something resembling talent, was a departure from the young conservative voices seen on YouTube back in the day, like early conservative YouTuber Lee Dolin.
And I make it some of my videos in 15 minutes just in my apartment where I'll just talk to a camera.
Compared to Dolin, Crowder was bursting with charisma, or at the very least, energy. Crowder's talking points were old, but his presentation was a breath of fresh air, so it's not surprising that the conservative media space snapped him up so quickly. By June of 2009, less than a year from the earliest Crowder video we can find online, Steven Crowder was working with Pajama Television, or PJTV, which marked a noticeable increase in his production values.
Well, I agree with you, Keith. You're so smart. Thank you, Rachel.
If you're wondering what the hell Pajama Television is, it's a part of Pajamas Media, which was started by Charles Johnson, a software developer and writer Roger L. Simon. It was financed by tech billionaire Aubrey Chernick, and takes its name from a screw-up in mainstream media after Dan Rather used some forged documents in a news report on George W. Bush. When this mix-up was revealed by bloggers online, it was embarrassing for the network. A former CBS News executive said, "You couldn't have a starker contrast between the multiple layers of checks and balances at 60 Minutes and a guy sitting in his room in his pajamas." That's how pajamas got affixed to a conservative media outlet. As part of PJTV, Crowder would continue to produce short videos, though there was less of an emphasis on stand-up and more on sketches. The funding also gave Crowder the ability to tackle more ambitious projects. Instead of short comedy videos running 3 to 5 minutes, he would start producing longer pieces running over 10 minutes that had him traveling to places such as Montreal and Detroit. These longer videos are much like the shorter ones in that they parrot common conservative talking points, mixing in Crowder's particular type of humor. The most egregious of these was Crowder's visit to Guantanamo Bay in a vital titled, "The Real Guantanamo Bay." Here's how it opens. This whole video is a very odd defense of the prison, which held hundreds of people without any sort of trial because they were suspected of being terrorists. It conflates what Guantanamo Bay is like for people in the US military with brief hints at the experiences of prisoners. The fact that the guards have a nice life doesn't somehow make it a lovely place to visit or a place you'd want to spend any time as a prisoner. The prison on Guantanamo Bay was the site of torture, with several detainees claiming to have experienced some form of it. And even a Bush administration official, Susan J. Crawford, spoke about one detainee remarking, "We tortured Mohammed al-Qahtani." Crowder's video came out 10 months after this admission from the Bush administration. In his video, Crowder spent some time talking about detainees living a pretty good life in prison.
"Not only do they have a beautiful ocean view, bountiful rec time, oftentimes video game privileges, access to language courses, laptop classes, and other various life skills training courses, they also get their own top-notch soccer field."
He then reads a list of rules on how troops are supposed to treat detainees, which is all well and good if that's what was actually happening.
"Our troops are not even allowed to force them to stand for prolonged periods of time, or threaten them, or cover their heads during transportation, or interrogate them for up to 20 hours, force them to do calisthenics, deprive them of sleep, or force them to shave."
Going back to the interview with Crawford, the techniques they used were all authorized, but the manner in which they applied them was overly aggressive and too persistent. You think of torture, you think of some horrendous physical act done to an individual. This was not any one particular act. This was just a combination of things that had a medical impact on him, that hurt his health. It was abusive and uncalled for, and coercive, clearly coercive. "It was that medical impact that pushed me over the edge. To call it torture," she said. These comments don't come from someone reading regulations in a book, but rather someone looking at the actual record of how certain detainees were treated. Crawford was convinced that Qahtani would have been part of the September 11th attack in 2001 had he been able to get into the United States, but him having been tortured kept her from recommending he go to trial for whatever role he had played in the operation beforehand. The U.S. Army defended the specific actions used to torture him as being lawful at the time, but afterwards the field manual would be updated to no longer allow those same techniques to be used, something Crowder doesn't mention in his video. While being detained, it is stated that Qahtani experienced beatings, forced enemas, and at one point they made him wear a leash and demanded he do dog tricks. Contexts like this may well have been known to Crowder, but I'm not sure he would have cared when you hear him say things like this.
"I personally believe that prison should be as unpleasant as humanly possible."
This whole video reads like an endorsement for torture. And even if the worst things said about Qahtani are true, that he was someone who would 9/11 America if he had the chance, that doesn't justify treating someone like a literal animal or putting their life at risk through abusive use of other interrogation techniques or assaulting them. This is the type of content Crowder was producing when he was scouted by Fox News and brought on board as a contributor in 2009. I'll get to his more notable Fox News work later on, but much of it was just him being a conservative talking head without much of the flair of his online work. His YouTube content around this time has a large gap of several months where he seems to have stopped working with PGA TV, and when he returns to the platform with a noticeable drop in production quality, his videos are now branded with nationalcenter.org in the top right corner. National Center is a conservative think tank pushing private market solutions as opposed to government involvement in issues such as healthcare, education, and a number of other projects. Crowder's star kept rising in this time as he hosted the annual conference for the Conservative Political Action Committee, or CPAC, in 2011. Apparently, they liked him enough to bring him back in 2012 for one of the cringiest rap performances I've ever seen in my life. One thing I noticed a lot in Crowder's earlier work that became less pronounced as time went on was how on occasion it worked really hard to pull at the heartstrings of its audience. In the video, Detroit in Ruins, Crowder Goes Ghetto, Crowder spends 12 minutes mocking the city and falsely blaming unions for the downturn of Detroit. There is an article linked below from Smithsonian Magazine that has an interesting counter to the talking point that Detroit was some kind of auto workers' paradise in the 1950s. But what I really want to highlight in this video is the final minute where things get very sappy.
When you continue to remove free market principles that have made this country great, and you continue to create a state-dependent society, this is very well what America could look like in a very short amount of time. And I think that's important.
He did something similar when he went to Mexico for another video. In a 2014 video, he dropped the jokes entirely and really went for the emotional jugular. This video was titled, Special Needs Abortion, a Holocaust.
You just immediately pick up on the fact that they are so much happier than most people.
I have many feelings about this video. On the one hand, presenting people who have Down syndrome with empathy and humanity is a good thing. That Crowder spends time with people to brighten their days is nice. But to then use that experience to make an anti-abortion video is something else entirely. People with Down syndrome are human beings who can choose to advocate for whatever they like. And if someone with Down syndrome wanted to make an anti-abortion video, I would disagree, but I would not find that as objectionable as this video. In this Crowder video, none of these people get a voice or give any indication that they support this cause. They're just shown on screen while Crowder provides all the narration. What Crowder is doing here is presenting being pro-choice as some form of eugenics that would eliminate these people from the population. It's a caricature of the left position. The conversation around abortion and Down syndrome in particular is a complicated one. Early detection of diseases during pregnancy is an incredibly valuable tool for preventing illnesses that would either lead to a late miscarriage or a child being born who would live with intense suffering for a few weeks or months and then die. But with Down syndrome, it's a bit more complicated as it's possible for someone who's diagnosed with it to live a perfectly healthy and happy life. Preventing a birth because the eventual child might have Down syndrome could be a reflection of our own ableism. When we think of it in that way, this isn't really a question about abortion and how it should be limited, but rather how we view and how we understand people with Down syndrome as part of our society. Crowder's video doesn't really tackle those difficult questions, though. He instead is opting to make the less thoughtful anti-abortion point. An interesting article by Sarah Zhang was written in The Atlantic in 2020 that tackled this issue, though, and you can read it linked below if you're curious to hear from people and families confronted with this very complicated issue. What certainly doesn't help is comparing these difficult moral choices to the Holocaust and portraying a pregnant person as a Nazi if they don't believe they would be able to provide a child with Down syndrome a reasonable quality of life. This whole video also plays into the angelic innocent trope, as if these people are simply floating through life on wings of joy, instead of recognizing that they live in the same society we do. In that way, these people are used twice as props. And it makes me question Crowder's sincerity when he talks about concern over people with Down syndrome. And to reinforce that point, let's take a quick trip to the present day to see how Steven Crowder discusses people with Down syndrome and whether or not they might appreciate a doll that looks a bit more like them.
Down syndrome Barbie.
Short bus, not included.
Did she have to say smash through barriers when we all know about special needs strength? Yes. None of them ever thought, I don't feel represented.
Right.
They never complained about it. They were totally fine.
mocking a doll for being more inclusive and then claiming to speak for people with Down syndrome, again, reveals the depth of Crowder's feelings here. I'm sure he cares vaguely for people with Down syndrome, but he's more interested in using them in his fight against abortion or as part of some endless culture war. He seems to have no problem with his co-hosts using ableist slurs towards a doll that represents a group he supposedly cares so much about. Even Christian anti-abortion groups called him out for this particular segment of his show. Going back to this old Crowder video, though, this could have simply been a video about the importance of services to be provided for these people, or how we should approach these people with kindness and compassion, but it skips the first part and only vaguely references the second to instead focus on the exploitative point, and it reveals how grotesque Crowder's work often is when you strip away the attempts at humor. Stepping back from the awful content of this video, though, it is the strangest one I came across strictly from a stylistic perspective. Unlike Crowder's other videos, this one is intentionally humorless. Of the hundreds of videos he's made, I'm not sure how many others are quite like this, but I'd wager it's a very small minority from the many videos of his I've sampled over the years. And his more recent stuff seems far less likely to stray into territory that is so maudlin. I've mostly been talking about Steven Crowder's YouTube work, but let's go back to his time at Fox News. He was there from 2009 to 2013. Most of that time was spent being a standard talking head, and Crowder himself would later remark that it wasn't his most inspired work. Most of his appearances, from the few I could find, were pretty unremarkable, one of the few notable exceptions when he was on a panel with Amy Schumer and she made him look silly in 2010.
You know, you slip by the dirty comedian thing, but honestly, you call yourself a comedian, but you don't do it that much. Like, I go fishing a couple times a year, but I don't introduce myself on TV as a fisherman.
Wow.
By far, though, Crowder's biggest moment on Fox News was in late 2012 when he was put into heavy rotation on the channel after he uploaded a YouTube video of himself getting punched in the face by a union worker.
You just assaulted me, right?
Before going into details about this punch and how it was deceptively edited by Crowder to hide the fact that the union guy thought he was defending himself, let's rewind a bit to get a better idea of how Crowder views violence. One thing Crowder is very quick to remind his audience of is that he works out and he practices Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. He often offers workout tips and even uploaded a video in 2011 of his visit to the Gracie Jiu-Jitsu Academy. The video is more or less just an advertisement for that school. However, Crowder didn't quite seemed so ready for violence a few months later in a video titled Occupy Assaults in Denver. This was filmed during a protest by Occupy Denver of conservative blogger convention, BlogCon 11.
Freedom of speech blocker! Stop! Freedom of speech blocker! Freedom of speech blocker! Stop insulting!
No violence! No violence!
The only reason you're shouting me is because you're a weak, out of shape older lady who knows I won't hit you.
It's a bit tricky to see what's going on in this footage, and this camera angle was a very strange choice because there were loads of different cameras on the scene that day offering a number of different angles. But this one best captures the moment where Crowder talks tough to a woman half his size who supposedly assaulted him. But like I said, there are plenty of other videos of this event, like this one where you can see Crowder reaching out over the woman's shoulder before she raised her arm to push him back. I suspect Crowder went with the footage he did, which wasn't his own, because it captured his spicy threat to the protester. It also didn't reveal that he was very much invading her space. The whole altercation didn't get much attention at the time outside of the online conservative media space, which is probably why you've never heard of it. A week later, in a video titled Occupy's Greatest Hits, featuring Carl Winslow, Crowder mocked the protesters, highlighting one particular arrest.
We are equal!
Well, at least that's an approved arrest control technique, although unnecessary.
Seeing a hippie beaten up was everything I'd hoped it would be.
Crowder's reaction here, and the joy he takes in seeing these protesters be roughly handled by police, is worth keeping in mind. It's not that he's against violence at a protest, it's just that he believes police are the ones who should be enacting violence upon protesters. Going back to the woman who supposedly assaulted Crowder, it really seems like he was trying to get some kind of reaction from her. Countering a protest is fine, but surrounding someone with cameras and invading their personal space reveals this to be a feeding frenzy of conservative bloggers trying to make hay out of an unexpected protest. And Crowder chose the footage that let him look like both a victim and a tough guy standing up to a mean protester. So from all of this, I think it's safe to say that, to a degree, some of Crowder's behavior in these situations can be a bit provocative. This sort of provocative behavior is seen again a year later when Steven Crowder went to a union protest in Michigan. In December of 2012, unions were protesting a right-to-work law that would limit the power of unions from collecting labor dues, effectively weakening their ability to collectively bargain, giving employers greater power over their workers. To express support for this legislation, Crowder joined the Americans for Prosperity group present, Americans for Prosperity being a libertarian conservative political advocacy group funded by the Koch brothers that has been working to weaken unions across the United States and fight against increases to the minimum wage. The details of what happened that day are a little bit messy, but I'll try to sort them out as best I can and give you some sense of what this timeline was. During the protest by union workers, counter-protesters led by Americans for Prosperity were also present. They had set up two large tents on the grounds. During the protest, as both sides shouted at each other, both of these tents eventually came down. There is a lot of discussion over who knocked over these tents, with union workers being blamed by right-wing media, and workers claiming that members of American for Prosperity were the ones pulling out pegs and egging on union members to take part. Regardless of who started this, there is ample video evidence of what appear to be several workers who are cheering on the taking down of the tents, and some of them actively seem to be participating once the tents started to come down. They seem to be a small number of the total number of protesters who were there, but it is still unfortunate that they participated as someone easily could have gotten hurt. Aside from the tents coming down at the protest, it was largely an uneventful encounter. Here's a comment from police regarding the event. "We have not made any arrests at all. The crowd has been more than fine. They've been obeying what the fire marshal says in terms of building capacity. People have been coming in and out of the Capitol exercising their constitutional rights. We've been perfectly fine with them. Just that one small incident." That one small incident being the collapse of the tent. As you can see, it's a pretty big tent. Supposedly people were on the inside of at least one of the tents, though thankfully no one was hurt. There was some violence on the day though, and it's clearly seen in the video titled "Unions Assault on Camera," uploaded by Steven Crowder. This footage helped get Crowder a lot of attention, and the video currently sits at nearly 2 million views. Before getting to the reaction and media storm around it, I do think it's important we include some very crucial context that was omitted from this original video. This was eventually uploaded to Steven Crowder's channel 1 week later, this video being titled, "Unedited Union Assault Footage." It's a bit confusing when it's showing two angles of the same event at the same time, but in it we can clearly see that the worker was knocked to the ground before getting up and punching Crowder. Looking at just that footage, it's not entirely clear what's going on, though Crowder seemed to briefly have one hand on the guy before he went down. Whether that was enough to knock him down, or if he just tripped over something and that made him fall over, I'll leave it to you to judge. But regardless, the guy did seem to think Steven Crowder was responsible for knocking him over, and his response wasn't just a sudden sucker punch, but rather was an act of self-defense from his perspective. The additional footage that was included is to provide additional context of Crowder having people yell at him, which I think is meant to create the impression that he was under threat of imminent violence. Of course, he wasn't actually targeted with imminent violence until someone believed that he had initiated a violent encounter himself. Also, this isn't Crowder releasing all of his footage. Some of this comes from another YouTube channel, one clearly sympathetic to him, that titled its video, "Steven Crowder's Attacker Verbally Attacks Him an Hour Earlier." It makes this seem less like Steven Crowder trying to release all his footage to provide full context, and rather him trying to find footage that would make him appear as sympathetic as possible. More interesting than this actual event was Crowder's reception in right-wing media, where he made a number of appearances to talk about his brush with violence. Let's look at his appearance on Sean Hannity's program. It's here we can see Crowder really begin to embellish the story.
I literally believe, Sean, that if I'd have defended myself at all, even flicked a small little jab, that they would have killed me where I stood.
Crowder also mentioned some guy was threatening to shoot him with a gun.
Are we not addressing the fact that someone threatened to murder me with a gun on that tape too?
This is clearly not true when looking at the footage from another angle. The guy who shouts out this threat is screaming at someone off screen to the left, who isn't Steven Crowder in his leather jacket, clearly standing to the right. I don't think the threat was a good thing to yell out, of course, but it certainly wasn't directed at Steven Crowder. Something a lot of people forget about this whole altercation was that, in addition to trying to portray union members as thugs, Crowder was also very concerned with making sure everyone knew he was a tough guy.
Listen, I'm underrested, overworked right now, and still tough enough to take the union's greatest punch, apparently. I'm not that hurt.
He really, really wants you to know he's a tough guy.
You have a choice. You can come forward, I'll press charges, you'll go to jail, Or, since you wanted to cheap shot me, we can host a bout in a sanctioned, legalized MMA competition.
What was really important about this Hannity interview was that this is where the longer footage of the incident first made its appearance. Upon noticing that, other outlets started raising concern over whether this controversy was manufactured, since the original clip omitted some very important context. Crowder also had an interview at the Wall Street Journal that had a few interesting sections. Crowder said he did not file a police report because he lives over an hour away. It was a timing thing. I had to get back and offload the footage. I also have no interest in or energy to devote to suing this person, even though that's what people want. Gregory S. McNeil, the author of this article, to his credit, asks why the footage was cut before the punch in the original video. This is Crowder's response. The camera pans away because the camera was jostled. The cameraman was shoved around too. A bunch of people were being shoved as the protesters tried to tear down the tent. A tent which wasn't their property. They were tearing down a tent with women and children in it. And the man who was coming at me, I think, tripped over the tent peg, fell towards me. And that's when I said, "You assaulted me." Right after that, he sucker punched me. My guess is that he was on his way down. He grabbed me and started shoving me. I followed up again asking Crowder about the events leading to his statement, "You assaulted me," and whether it was possible the person, Tony, merely fell into him. Crowder stated, "At that point in time, they were shoving me. It had been shoving, with me saying, 'That's an assault,' and him getting up and hitting me. That shoving was immediately followed by a clear attack, as the video indicates." In an interview with writer Michael Corrin, Crowder admitted to getting physical that day.
"And we didn't get violent with them, but we did try and push them off the tent. That is true. We tried to push them off the tent that they were destroying because, as you saw, women were in there."
I'm not sure how pushing isn't assault when he does it, but shoving is when a person does it to him. But his commentary on all of this seems less designed to highlight an injustice and more a vehicle for him to raise his profile as much as possible. From his telling, you'd think Crowder was some brave hero arriving to protect the women, old people, children, and people in wheelchairs inside the tent. And I'm not exaggerating when I say that. At various points, Crowder has claimed all of those people were under that tent, or might have been under there.
"There are women in here. There are old people in here. We're down a tent with women and children." Well, some people in wheelchairs, by the way, in the tent.
But Crowder's claim that the workers he was confronting were taking down the tent is inaccurate. Here's a comment from Dr. Sandra L. Cade from the Michigan Peace Team who was present that day. "I saw a union marshal, trained in nonviolent response, ask and receive help in lifting the edge of the fallen tent in order to fold up the table because we want to make sure no one trips and gets hurt. I saw another use a pocket knife to slit through the tent fabric because an AFP guy asked for help in looking for his computer, which had been on the table. They didn't find it." You can even hear one of the union workers in some of the footage from Crowder's channel. He's clearly saying, "Get everybody out of there now.
Get everybody out of there now."
And in the footage, you can see people being helped from the tent. While some workers certainly were responsible for helping collapse that tent, a number of them were also doing their best to ensure that no one got hurt. This isn't an angry mob that was ready to tear Crowder limb from limb. We do see Crowder spring to action to confront the union worker cutting open a tent, quite possibly the one who was asked to cut open the tent by someone from Americans for Prosperity so he could find his computer. It's here where Crowder confronts the union workers with an unnamed man, and that's what immediately preceded the punch. Not quite the daring defense of the tent's integrity that Crowder makes it out to be. When Crowder went back on to Hannity the next night, Hannity's guest, Andy Sullivan, confronted him on how he used this footage.
"And then he came up off his feet." "Yeah, there he is. What is that, Steve?"
"He did go down. He was attacking a tent with women and children in it.
Oh, he was attacking the tent. And what were you doing?"
"We were there trying to prevent people from being hurt in the tent. You deserved what you got, sir.
I should note that Andy Sullivan made his name fighting against a mosque being built in New York City near the former site of the World Trade Center, so I'm not sure he's the hero we really want, but he does provide a useful bit of pushback in this instance. It was after all this negative media attention that Crowder finally released the longer version of the video online, over a week after the original edited version went up. Crowder did eventually file a criminal complaint, 2 days after the alleged assault, though a few months later, Ingham County Prosecutor Stuart Dunnings III announced he was declining to press charges. Here's an excerpt from an article detailing that. "It's pretty clear the person that they wanted to charge was acting in self-defense," Dunnings said of the union member who apparently slugged Crowder. Dunnings questions why Crowder didn't initially provide the original footage to Dunnings' office. "I'm not holding that against him, but why would they provide the edited video? The longer video clearly shows the guy got pushed down and came up swinging," Dunnings said. And that's the story of Steven Crowder getting punched in the face by a union worker. Towards the end of his tenure with Fox News, Crowder started working with Liberty Alliance to produce his YouTube content. Liberty Alliance being a conservative Christian publisher. This relationship didn't seem to last too long, as their logo only appeared in a few videos, including one where Crowder dressed up like Muhammad to make an anti-Islam joke. I only mention here because I want to be thorough in documenting every right-wing media outlet, think tank, and other organizations that have been funding this guy's career. In October of 2013, 10 months after getting punched in the face, Crowder was out at Fox News, ending his four-year run with the channel. The exact reason for his departure was never made entirely clear, but it's been suggested it was due to contract negotiations and Fox News' inflexibility to Crowder's demands. Up to this point, Crowder's career had almost entirely been working for various organizations. Aside from a few months on YouTube early on, he had worked with PJTV, National Center, Fox News, Liberty Alliance, and even had recurring appearances on Sun News, which was the short-lived Canadian version of Fox News. There was this brief period where Crowder made these short videos where he stood around in a void and delivered monologues about how it's okay to spank kids and other conservative talking points. And there are so few of these videos that I was going to only mention them in passing, since I don't have time to debunk every ridiculous thing he said in his content, but I do have to address this one.
It's never okay to abuse your children. Ever, 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 ever. But spanking or disciplining your child is not the same as abuse.
It actually is abuse. A milder form than some other types, obviously, but it is absolutely abuse. Crowder's point in this video, that calling spanking abuse somehow undermines the harsher forms that meet his own definition of abuse, is ridiculous. When it comes to the well-being of children, it shouldn't be a tough sell that any form of physical violence is bad. There's plenty of evidence to show that spanking not only doesn't provide any benefit, it also harms children. Maybe there's room for a debate on whether or not a fully grown adult getting shoved is assault or not, something Crowder apparently has mixed feelings on, but standards should be higher for children. Though this video makes me think Crowder is trying to justify his own treatment as a child.
You use foul language in front of the ladies?
No, daddy, no! But I was spanked, and you know what? I deserved it.
The next incarnation of Crowder is more familiar to anyone aware of his content today. It was the beginning of his talk show, Louder with Crowder. Now, while you might assume he started this on his own, having cut ties with Fox News, that would not be the case, as this all comes from him taking a job at Wham Talk 1600, a Michigan-based conservative talk radio station. The radio station would help with production of the new show, and Crowder would fill their 6 a.m. Friday morning time slot. The earliest episodes of this show have been lost to time, as they were primarily broadcast over the radio. But starting in November of 2014, Crowder would begin uploading these programs as a podcast, appearing on most major platforms. Around this time, he also started uploading videos from this show to his YouTube channel. While only clips and extended interviews from the show were put up at first, gradually he would begin uploading entire episodes a little over a year into the show's life, starting with episode number 60. For this video, I'm going to go back to the very first episodes of Louder with Crowder that exist in podcast form, pulling out some interesting sections. Since it mostly exists as audio, there won't be much in the way of footage. And what footage I did find comes from clips from longer episodes and may not be directly connected to the audio you're hearing. But all of it does come from the Louder with Crowder program. Crowder's show at this time was slightly detached from the news of the day. There was a much greater emphasis on guests and interviews, and it focused more on broader cultural issues rather than the nitty-gritty of electoral politics. He would still take time to discuss the Republican primaries, but he also devoted time to talking with personal trainers about how to get in better shape, or advice gurus on how to be a man. It was a conservative show, yes, but it was broad in its scope. It's relatively easy to find things in these early episodes that are funny to hear in a modern context, such as Crowder explaining his feelings on the word cracker being used to describe a white person.
I have literally known zero people in my life who are offended by the term cracker. If someone is offended by the term cracker, it's usually some white guy who's trying to create a moral equivalency with the N-word. Like, well, why can they say cracker? Because they can, you idiot. It's not the same thing.
It's also fun to find some of the many anti-Trump rants he went on before Trump won the Republican nomination.
Here's my thing with Donald Trump. I'm not a huge fan. Let me tell you why.
Okay.
Supported Obama in 08, enthusiastically. Has given at least $100,000 to the Clinton Foundation. All we know is it's at least $100,000, under $250,000, back during her Senate campaign. Gross abuses of eminent domain in the courts to try and take property from private citizens. I just can't believe that so many conservatives have had the wool pull over their eyes. I'd rather take Donald Trump over a politician. And then in the same breath, they go, well, of course she had to give to Democrats. She was in New York. That's how business gets done. Well, then how is he not a politician? Donald Trump is a card carrying Democrat. Has been. Now, not like Ronald Reagan at one point and then changed. Recently supported Hillary Clinton. Recently gave six figures to Hillary Clinton. Wasn't giving it to Republicans, by the way. Recently supported Barack Obama. His whole life acted as a lawsuit-delivering pro-Democrat liberal. For most of his life.
If you're curious who he was supporting, at the time he was a big Carly Fiorina guy. As the former head of HP, she spent most of the race far away from the top spots, aside from a few brief weeks where she topped out at 15%. Many of these positions clearly clash with modern conservative talking points, and we can point to this being hypocrisy, or it could simply be Crowder evolving as a person. And while that game is fun, I think there are some other constants in his commentary that are more interesting. For example, Crowder was doing anti-trans content from the very beginning of this program. When alarms were being raised over Drag Time Story Hour, a lot of people circulated footage from this 2015 video titled Hidden Cam, Cross-Dressing at Planet Fitness, which featured Steven Crowder dressed in drag, going into a Planet Fitness and making a bit of a scene until he was thrown out.
Weights just up. Just help lift them up.
Crowder really hates Planet Fitness. He complains about them several times in these early episodes. I suspect it's because he was banned after he kept dropping weights while working out, which is also why he was kicked out when he was in drag. And much like his earliest videos, drag is something Crowder has a real knack for.
I'm good at dressing in drag and doing hidden camera videos.
I don't know about you're good at dressing in drag. You didn't look really good.
That second voice you hear there is Dan Martin, nicknamed Fun Dip, on account of Crowder noticing a Fun Dip nearby when the two of them first met. Martin was Crowder's first producer until mid-2015. He would eventually be replaced by Jared Monroe, also known as Not Gay Jared, who was already working as the producer for the online content before Martin left. Martin is interesting. Him being employed by the radio station meant he wasn't on Crowder's payroll the way future producers who worked with him would be. And even though he works for a conservative radio station, his politics aren't necessarily as extreme as Crowder's. He has a number of right-wing opinions, such as being anti-choice, but Martin was surprisingly pro-trans and would often argue against the more transphobic things Crowder would say on the air.
You said that I was a bigot. That pisses me off.
You were behaving in that way.
How was I behaving? What did I say that was bigoted, Fun Dip?
You refuse to use the pronouns that people want to be referred to by.
So?
It's just not nice.
It's not a bigot. Doesn't make me a bigot.
A bastard, maybe?
Martin was not nearly as aggressive a debater as Crowder, and his compassion for trans people comes from having and accepted a trans friend. Instead of engaging with realities like that, we instead see Crowder retreat to bogus science. Luckily, that doesn't keep Martin from pushing back.
Because you just said that, hey, if only I knew illegal immigrants, if only I knew more liberals, and they just told me their story personally, I would change my opinion on all of it.
Well,
that's
not
what you
necessarily,
said.
But I would at least have a better understanding of their plight.
Exactly. So you're saying you have no understanding of their plight. Now, see, I'm not. I'm saying that my opinions are across the board based on data, based on sociological studies.
Crowder often would cite science in these arguments, though his sources were rarely specific. For example, he claimed that conversion therapy reduced the suicide rate of trans people.
The suicide rate, I've got it right in front of me, is 40%. Well, 40%, and it's because, now,
but
it's not nearly as high for those who go through the psychiatric counseling and just say, hey, you're actually a man.
A large-scale study has since revealed the opposite to be true, as conversion therapy is associated with nearly doubling the suicide rate. Granted, the study came out a few years after Crowder made this claim, but the practice has been labeled as ineffective by the American Psychological Association back in 2012, instead recommending gender-affirming care. What Martin's example shows is that, even before getting into the science of the subject, it's possible to express empathy and kindness to the people in your life. And in spite of some of his other bad takes, it's sometimes hard not to root for him when he's standing up to Crowder. Although Crowder presents himself as being more educated on the subject, albeit built on a faulty understanding of the science behind it, one shouldn't need to have an in-depth knowledge of the science behind trans people when it comes to offering people the basic empathy and respect that you should show anyone in your life. And whether or not someone requires any kind of medical treatment is really none of your business unless you're that person's doctor. If someone isn't harming anybody else and they seem to be happy living their life, who are you to tell them that they need to experience some kind of conversion therapy, which, by the way, has been highlighted as a form of torture? Another major feature of these early programs is the endless complaining about Islam. Anyone familiar with conservative media of that era know exactly what I'm talking about. Although if you were too young to have experienced this firsthand, here's a sample of just how extreme the talking points were.
Islam, not every individual Muslim, Islam is worse than Nazism.
What's particularly off-putting about this commentary is how obviously slanted it is. For example, he tries to list all the religions Christians live alongside harmoniously to differentiate it from Islam.
Christians live alongside Catholics, Protestant Christians and Catholics. No problem.
Christians don't even get along with other Christians. And when Christians aren't fighting one another, they are absolutely persecuting other religions. From the historic expelling of Jewish people from various Christian nations in Europe, to the many violent wars between Christian and Islamic powers, never mind the absolute grotesque genocide of indigenous peoples around the world. Christians have shown they very much have difficulties living peacefully alongside other religions. Crowder's understanding of Islam is taken from a flat reading of the Quran, not any sort of historical or modern understanding of how Islam is practiced around the world. And let's be very clear that when Crowder criticizes Muslims, he means the majority, including those living in the United States, as being incompatible with his way of life. In one particularly interesting episode, he interviews a woman who supposedly escaped a bad marriage living in the US. Since her identity is hidden, none of the details of her story can really be corroborated, but that's not as important as some of the commentary that comes from Steven Crowder.
If you're a woman, you have no power at all to divorce your husband. None at all, if he doesn't want to. None at all.
Yeah, they make it out like women are property.
Pretty much. They can abuse their wives. It's very, very common. Women are not allowed to leave the home. A man can divorce her with three words, divorce, divorce, divorce.
Now we get to the trickiest thing in this video to discuss, Steven Crowder's ongoing divorce, which began in 2021, that was made very public in early 2023. Particularly the video where he is verbally abusive to his wife. Going back to the clips where Crowder was criticizing Islam for supposedly denying women the right to divorce on their own and not being allowed to leave their house.
They can abuse their wives. It's very, very common. Women are not allowed to leave the home.
No, you're not taking the car. You're not taking the car. Steven. You are not.
If you're a woman, you have no power at all to divorce your husband. None at all, if he doesn't want to.
And I still believe that children need a mom and a dad and that divorce is horrible. But in today's legal system, my beliefs don't matter. In Texas, divorce is permitted when one party wants it, period.
Back when working for Fox News, Crowder wrote an op-ed that aged incredibly poorly titled, "I am a guy and I'll never badmouth my wife." In it, Crowder talks about how much he cares for his wife and wags his finger at all the guys who have stories about their wives being difficult to live with. One section in particular really rings out. Firstly, there may be some people out there who actually believe their wife to merely be the old ball and chain. To you, I say, you are a loser. Not only are you a loser for dishonoring the woman who is now an extension of yourself, but you're a loser for picking someone who you hate having to come home to every night. What kind of an idiot are you to marry a person that you think is an absolute moron? And only a few years later, he would be complaining about her on his radio show, and a few years after that, the marriage would be over. Steven Crowder's personal life, including his marriage, should certainly stay private. But when he uses that marriage as evidence to advance his agenda, I think it's fair to examine that evidence to see if he's using it accurately. Crowder has used his marriage to advance his Christian conservative agenda, supposedly living the life of a moral man, acting as an exemplar of virtue when he's just as bad as the scary Muslims he imagines. When he mocks his wife in public, he acts as though his reasons and motivations are far superior to the other men who don't have the same evidence of his abusive behavior for the world to see. Steven Crowder is constantly wagging his finger at people who aren't as fit as him and other conservatives for not being as good as him at advancing their politics. His program is incredibly judgmental, and there's a real irony in someone telling people how to live their lives according to his values when he doesn't live up to them himself. But listening to these old episodes, I don't think it's his advice that really drives engagement with his work, and it's certainly not the comedy. The appeal of this guy can be summed up very well in one episode where Dan Martin reacts to Crowder after one of his rants.
Yeah, you get all hopped up and it's like, man, I never get that excited about anything anymore. I don't know if it's because I'm old and I don't have the energy, but when I watch somebody get that animated, it just, for some reason, it was very amusing, even though you were talking about a really serious subject.
That, I think, is the appeal of someone like Crowder made vocal. People tune into him because they want to feel something, and he makes them feel it. only the emotions they're feeling are ugly ones. I had to really think over whether or not to include that section on Steven Crowder's divorce. Even though all the information I used is publicly available, there's something about using a person's private life and tying it to their commentary that I find a bit objectionable. Ultimately, I thought it was more important to address it head-on, considering this is a conversation that Crowder began himself. By using his marriage as part of his commentary and bringing his wife onto his show, he's made his marriage part of his commentary. And while we don't have any right to invade his privacy, once information is publicly available, we can't pretend like we don't see it. We can't look at his commentary and just pretend we don't know how horribly abusive he was to his ex-wife. If you enjoyed this video, please consider becoming a patron or member, like the fine people whose names you see coming up the screen now. You can also like, comment, subscribe, hit the bell for notifications. Thank you all so much for watching.